very much. Yes, let me, maybe you can hear me good, clear?
Yeah.
Perfect. And then I will start my presentation. I want to share the screen one moment. So now you can see my presentation?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, perfect. Yeah, thank you very much for your introduction. So also welcome from my side. Of course, it's a great pleasure for me to be able to present some of our recent research work here at this symposium. So I think it's a great opportunity for us to talk a little bit more about artificial intelligence. Rafael, thank you very much for your last answer and hint to the synthetic data. So I will talk about this in the next 25 minutes. So I'm not really focusing at the moment at, about a very specific algorithm, so that there's an application maybe for using artificial intelligence for maybe supporting the construction in a certain way. I want to talk a little bit about the, I think, very essential aspect which we need when we are when we want to apply artificial intelligence, the data for training. So as we heard before, so we need a lot of data sets that are well labeled, well annotated, and that we can bring in, and we can then maybe train our neural networks or other artificial intelligence application. So I will talk a little bit about this, because it's very important that we have very good and maybe also very big data sets, and which are more or less correctly labeled. And this is also a big challenge, that sometimes we're using data sets, and of course we have hundreds, thousands of images, for example, and maybe there are some images which are not correctly labeled, and then maybe in the end our results are not reliable, or we cannot apply this in practical application. So therefore my talk today is about synthetic training data for machine learning in construction. Let me start also with a short overview. So I think Rafael did this very well during his presentation. So here I will only want to show there are so many different methods in the field of artificial intelligence. And of course, also this domain is really developing very, very fast, and a lot of new algorithms are coming up maybe every month, and it's sometimes it's really hard to follow. And of course, machine learning, I'm focusing on machine learning at the moment. It's only a part of the whole domain, and we have this rule-based system and expert system, all the other concepts around artificial intelligence. And here, when we are talking about machine learning, it's more like it's data driven. So that means that we are not really programming directly an algorithm that we are doing maybe for a finite element simulation. It's more like that we have some data and we train a model. So of course there's some programming behind this, but it's more like the data is the essential input for our algorithm or our model. So also in the next, so when I'm talking now about machine learning, I will narrow this down also to some aspects. So in general, if you're talking about machine learning, then you can talk about supervised, unsupervised, reinforcement learning. And of course, nowadays we are all talking about deep learning, very special application of special concept in the whole domain of machine learning. So if we are talking about machine learning, we can do with this machine learning algorithms, classification, predictions, optimization. You see a bunch of applications on this slide. And of course, when I'm now talking a little bit about machine learning, I will focus on classification, only a small aspect. And based on this application, I want to explain a little bit more about what is so essential about preparing data in a very good, also reliable way, and how we can improve this with synthetic data. So, and one thing I want to add, and I will only show some applications regarding to deep learning. So that means, so we are not doing some kind of feature extraction at the beginning, and then maybe we use our support vector machines, and then we can use them for classification, like this is shown on this slide here. So the advantage of deep learning, of course, is that we can combine this feature extraction and also the classification. So we only have to provide input data. And of course, we have to provide some information what we want to classify. And of course, we have to do some labeling that we say on in this image, when I'm talking now about images, on this image we see in a certain region, maybe in this case here, a car, or maybe when we are now coming to the construction site, or maybe to different applications in construction, then we have, of course, different objects you want to classify. So in general, I would say we have so many applications only regarding classification based on images. So of course, the whole task is to detect an object, maybe this is a worker or a machine or equipment, or as you can see, some damages, whatever. And of course, one thing is the detection, and of course, then of course we want to classify what exactly is this object. So what is the type, especially if you are talking about damages, do we have a crack? Do we have an area where some material is missing, or we have a deformation, whatever. And of course, then we also want to calculate maybe what is the size, the width, the dimension, and in which area this object is located. And then if we know this, then we can use this as also, I think the other explained very well in the previous presentations, that we can use this information for different tasks to improve work safety, to optimize maybe the material flow on the construction site. So regarding the logistics, of course, quality measurement, damage detection during the operation phase, and of course, very challenging. And I think this is a big topic, not of my talk, but in general is of course reconstruction, or we call this to create a digital twin or as built model. Therefore, we don't have only not only have to detect some objects, so we have really to extract information like dimensions, maybe also geometry out of the images, maybe also point clouds, and then we would try to really create a digital model here. So, however, the problem is always that we have not enough data for training. So we have some good data sets, one is presented here, but for a lot of applications, these data sets are not existing or not so huge, which we normally need, especially for deep learning, because for deep learning, we need really, really a lot of, for example, here images to train a very good, maybe a neural network in the end. And therefore, I will now focusing a little bit more about the preparation of this input training data. So what we do now is that we, of course, we take some pictures. Here are some examples, not from the construction domain, from other domains. And then maybe we use different cameras. This is always a good idea, because sometimes the training depends on the camera you use, you're using for the images to make the images or the photos. And of course, different resolutions, different sizes, of course, light and shadow plays a big role. And of course, for us in the construction domain, of course, also the different national, I would say, characteristics, like we have maybe in Germany other colors on the construction site, maybe other equipment, and maybe also other signs. And we have to train this model then maybe only for Germany or for US or maybe China. And if you want to have maybe a neural network in the end or a deep learning method, which is able to detect objects from several countries, then of course we have to train this also for several national characteristics here. And the problem is how we can create enough data for training. So one thing is, of course, we use existing images and we rotate them, then we maybe do some modification, applying some filters is always not not good, that we only modify this by using maybe a Photoshop or whatever. So it better would be to add maybe some specific things or cut it into pieces. Sometimes, of course, so this is one problem to get enough images. The another problem is really to label them. So to really annotate what is on this picture, is there really, and in this case, a statue on it? And therefore we use sometimes crowdsourcing. Maybe everybody knows this. If you want to log into a system, sometimes you get this question, please click the images and on which we have a statue or a car or whatever. And in general, we do the training or the annotation for the others, that they make more reliable data sets and maybe bring this in for the next training. Nowadays, everybody's talking about maybe synthetic data. There are some very nice applications already developed. Here's an example. Of course, you can just train something with a virtual environment like here. If the shapes are very symmetric, or if you have some products which are really easy to distinguish, like here, so you have some boxes, some spheres, and so on. And of course, then maybe you can directly use without real images, the images of virtual environment. And here I want to talk a little bit about these two aspects. So first I want to talk how we can maybe integrate some pictures from virtual environments. This is one approach. So that means I will first highlight a little bit what we did before we integrated our synthetic data here. So we, in previous research, we tried to support the crane operators in the way that we try to detect moving objects, especially construction workers on construction sites, under the crane or under the crane load, and then maybe give some input. There is maybe a construction worker in a hazard area, and maybe then we get some, we can create some warnings for the worker and also for the crane operator. So we are taking images from a camera mounted on a crane and maybe on a platform. And of course the resolution is always the challenge. We have this top view. It's sometimes not so easy because you only maybe see the helmet and maybe some parts of the vest. And of course, if you can, you can also use some kind of Kalman filters to do the tracking between different images, that you can in the end track the worker and can calculate maybe the direction, and maybe you can warn early enough the crane operator if the worker is approaching or is coming into a certain area. So we also created a training set. It was not so easy for us. So we took 1,000 positive worker examples for the training, and of course a lot of other where we have no workers on our images. And of course it's always it's always a challenge to have a good variety. So it means we need maybe several workers in one picture, different lighting conditions, maybe varying backgrounds, moving vehicles, different cameras, and so on and so on. And of course, we have to do the labeling. So in the end, we have to mark every worker and say, this is a worker. Maybe also we can say, we want to detect the helmet and maybe also the vest. So we have the possibility, of course, to add different annotations to the images, but we have to do this manually in the end. So of course, this is a big effort. Sometimes this effort is much higher than and taking the pictures. So the labeling is really a challenge, and maybe you need some experience to do this in a correct way. So what we did, we used a standard deep learning, machine learning algorithm, the YOLO version 3 detector. It's very common convolutional neural network for real-time detection. So it's a really, really good algorithm, and you can do a multi-label approach, so you can have different classes and different sizes of the bounding boxes and so on. And in this example, we trained this network and we measured the precision. So we used the COCO MAP score for that. That's the mean average you are considering precision and recall. And we did this for a certain frame rate and a certain image size C. So we're coming up with a result where the detection rate in the end of 86% roundabout. It's not so good. So therefore we thought maybe we can add some synthetic data. So we created a virtual environment. So we used a very good system Blender. Maybe you're familiar with this sort of software systems to create really realistic images. So we built up some kind of scenarios. We modified the lighting, and we can add clouds and so on. And of course, we can change the colors of the clothes of the workers. Maybe we add some different safety vests and helmets, and also we have some moving objects in the scene. And very nice was that we used a motion capture data set so that we have a very realistic movement on the construction site. And we set up some scenarios. So we wanted to analyze which training data is good to improve our data set. And therefore we divided this into different scenes. I want only to highlight some scenes that we have a scene where we have a very bright light condition with sharp shapes, shadows here, and of course then we have a rainy day and other things. In general, we created only one site, and we did some variation on this site in the end. What is the outcome? So we put the camera into the scene, took some pictures. Here are some pictures of the virtual environment. And of course, in the end, we have had to do some labeling. Of course, you can do this in an automatic way because you are knowing this is a worker. And of course, then it's easy to label them and to annotate the images. So there was no manual effort. And of course, if you are a little bit experienced with these virtual environments, you can build up very easily based on existing libraries, a very nice and realistic construction site. So what is the result here? So we added additional data in a way that we always add the data from one scene to our data set, did the training, and then of course we had the had good result in the end, that we coming here with better result of 94% in the end. Of course, some data sets did not have a big impact because maybe we have covered this already with our data set. Some data sets were very helpful to increase our precision or our robustness of this detector. So I know I have not enough time because I can talk about this very long. I want to show my second example here about generative deep learning. So this is a little bit in the other direction. I only want to highlight the application here. We are considering the application of damage classification based on images. This is very common, and you can also, I think, nowadays you can buy some frameworks for that that you can easily integrate. However, this is a little bit different because the damages are always a little bit different. So we have different cracks, different sizes, and so on. It's not really an object in this case, which is very regular. So therefore, maybe synthetic data based on a virtual environment is not really useful. So also here, we created an own data set. So we need a lot of data for this application. So we created a data set with 10,000 images manually in different countries. And we did an annotation. So we really marking every crack, every aspect. You have to do this in a manual way. And we, of course, we store this in a data set format. It's a very common Cuckoo set data format that we can use this for different algorithm here. And of course, we also developed based on an existing framework, our own convolutional neural network for the damage detection. And in the end, the results were not bad. So, but also we think maybe we can improve this by adding synthetic data, but maybe in another kind of synthetic data. Therefore, we are looked into the modern artificial and intelligent algorithm, generative adversarial networks here, GNNs. So they are using to create fake images. So maybe you're knowing this from fake persons, images, faces. So these are fake faces. They are not realistic. They are generated based on an existing data set of real person or real people here. And then they create synthetic faces based on this data set. So this concept is very nice because it consists of two neural networks. So we have a generator model, which learns based on the distribution of the training set data and generate the fake data, the new data. And then we have the discriminator who is doing the classification. So he's classifying if this is a fake image or a real image. So of course we have to do some training here. And in the end, we have a reinforcement learning approach here because we are using both in a way that the generator wants to win against the discriminator. This is the idea behind this GNN concept. So in the end, we have a neural network consists of a dense layer and convolutional layers for the generator. So this dense layer is used to integrate noise, some random data or random numbers. That based on these random numbers, we can generate some fake images in the end, or fake samples, I would say it here. So this is very important that we, of course, can generate something which is not existing. And then, of course, the discriminator is quite simple. It's only a binary classification. So and we only have to distinguish between it's a fake or a real image. So here, the concept is also that at the beginning, you are training maybe more the discriminator model, and then you say, okay, I'm stopping now, and now I try to improve the generator. And then that in the end, of course, the discriminator cannot check if this is a real image or a fake image. Well, he's thinking it's a real image in the end. So this is working very well. So this is in the application of face recognition. They are doing this in several applications, as you can see.
I just asked you to finish up because you're now eating into your question time. So
okay,
you're going to create a situation where you'll have no questions at the end.
Okay, if you finish up. I need only 2 minutes. Okay, thank you. So this is working well, very well, and our first results are also very promising. So here you can see we use this with our training sets for the damages. So of course you have to do a lot of iterations. So in the end, after long calculation, and of course you need a lot of computer power, in the end you get a very promising result. We want to publish this in a journal paper in the near future. One other aspect, the last one I want to mention, we can also generate the labeling. So we call this a ground truth, that we not only have the images, so we need also the labels that we can say there is a crack and not. And also this we can generate based on our model we developed here, and this is also very helpful because in the end you don't have to do the manual labeling. Of course we need some experts to check this. This is also very important that in the end someone is looking on these fake images and if they are really realistic or only the discriminator thinks they are realistic. So this is of course also a manual proof we have to do at the end. Coming to the conclusion, I have only one slide for the conclusion. So I only want to mention here, very, very important is that we have enough data sets. So, and this is really a big challenge at the moment, not only for images, maybe also of course, text for maybe point clouds or whatever we are using to train our deep learning methods. And I only want to highlight here one initiative of the German Research Foundation. It's really, I think this is very helpful. They want to build up an open source cloud system where we can store and provide research data. And I only can say here that we are looking forward to use this, and maybe also the companies, maybe there, which are maybe here also at this symposium, maybe can add some data that we can create better deep learning models. Thank you very much, and sorry for the little bit delay in my presentation.